Hello and welcome to the Darkened Room of Music Conversation.
I'm Darren.
And I'm Chris. And we decided that because The Weeknd just released a brand new album called Dawn FM, that we do a rapid record rating again.
Absolutely.
But after listening to it, nah, we got to expand. This can't be that rapid.
Yeah. So this will not be a rapid record review.
No, not
this time. Okay, I get it. I like it. So that's good.
So we're going to go track by track, you know, reveal our individual rating for each individual track, kind of discuss what we thought of each one. And then at the end, we'll reveal our individual scores for the entire album and then add them together for a composite Darren and Chris score.
There we go. We're both big fans of The Weeknd.
Oh, yeah. I really love The Weeknd. So I was really excited when this came out. I'm like, oh, we got to do an episode on it.
Same here.
Yeah. All right. Cool. So let's get into it. Dawn FM was released on January 7th, 2022. Has already had three singles released. Well, I say three. Two have been released. Take My Breath was August 6th. We heard that along a while back. So
right.
I'm already familiar with that one. Sacrifice, the second single, released January 7th. And there's going to be a third single, although I think it's already
out
on the YouTubes and all that. Gasoline officially will be released on January 18th.
Exactly. Right. So, yeah, I'd heard the first two that you mentioned.
Yeah.
I'd heard those songs.
Now, something that I didn't reveal to you, but I did read this earlier.
Yeah.
And it may have affected my score a little bit. The Weeknd describes the album's concept as a state of purgatory, a journey towards the light at the end of the tunnel, serving as a follow-up to his album, After Hours.
Okay.
So this is supposed to be a concept album.
Okay. All right.
So let's start off with track one. What do you say?
All right. So track one is the intro, which is simply called Dawn FM Intro.
That's right.
And something kind of sounded familiar about this.
You are now listening to 103.5 Dawn FM. You've been in the dark for...
What was it?
Yeah, that was Jim Carrey.
Oh, wow. Jim Carrey. Yeah. So he's kind of like the narrator through a lot of this album.
Yeah, he's kind of like the radio DJ on Dawn FM,
right?
Kind of narrating your way through purgatory,
right?
Throughout the entire thing. Yeah, and I think he's got a great voice for it.
So let me ask you this: did it at least cross your mind a little bit, like Radio Chaos,
where rock and roll comes out of chaos, and a song called "The Powers That Be"?
A little bit, yeah.
It did me too.
Certainly came to mind.
Yeah,
because same kind of technique was used on that. But in this one, you know, it wasn't overdone.
Right.
I wouldn't say that Chaos was overdone, because that was the whole point of the album. And correct. It was a shorter album, too, only like 8 tracks.
Right.
But yeah, I think it was interspaced through the album and not too much.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, well said. I gave the song, the intro, it's not really a song, it's an intro. I gave it a 7 because I think it sets it up nicely for what's going to come.
Yeah, I gave it an 8 because it did flow very well into the next song. It's a smooth transition right into Gasoline.
Exactly.
Yeah, and boy, let's talk about 80s retro here.
Yeah, right away he sets the table with that 80s synth pop sound. Very reminiscent of like Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark.
Totally,
Or New Order, that kind of vibe, you know. Yeah. And whoever's singing on that, I guess maybe it's him, I don't know.
Yeah, well, there's no guest artist listed on this
track.
At
least not credited, right?
At least not credited.
Yeah, but so the voice is very... Yeah. You know, that kind of 80s.
It's one of those 80s new wave songs that crosses the threshold into 80s alternative a little bit.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And it's like, have I heard this before? This sounds very familiar. And that, to me, is kind of like a reoccurring theme for this whole album.
Oh, it is.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. There are so many times that I'm like, I know that song, but it's different.
Yeah, just the way he like puts the melodies, they're interwoven in between songs, and it's like, that's from Thriller, you know. It's just weird.
Yeah, I caught a few of those. Yeah.
You know, this song, I think it totally works. I liked it a lot. I gave it a 6.5.
Yeah, I gave it an 8.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The way I scored this stuff is, if it's 8 or higher, it's something that I might want to drop into a playlist.
All right.
And listen to over and over.
And I would say, if it's 8 or higher, I would seek out listening to it. If it's under that, if it's over 5, I wouldn't mind hearing it. If it's below 5, I'll probably change the dial.
Yeah. So let's go to the next track.
Yes,
How Do
Sir.
I Make You Love Me? This is track 3.
Another 80s song, 80s vibe.
Yeah.
You know, it reminded me of the Human League.
Yeah.
You know, that's what it reminded me of as I was mm-hmm. listening to it. Just the synth, I don't know, just all the little parts and
yeah.
the drum sounds even. Mm-hmm. I thought it was complete Human League. And yeah. what can I say? I'm a sucker for that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. I absolutely love the track.
I did too. I absolutely loved it. It bumped it up a notch to a 9.
I gave it an 8.5.
Very nice. Yeah. yeah. So, yeah, we agree on that one.
Yes, sir.
Now, it flows right into, I love how it transitions.
Yeah.
At the end of How Do I Make You Love Me, you hear the beat of Take My Breath
before coming the song in. Starts.
Yeah, and it goes right into it. Take my breath. I am making lots of breath. Man. When you, if you're going to construct a concept album, at least the first half of this album,
yeah.
this is like a blueprint. This is how you do it.
I completely agree. Yeah. And the album is continuous if we haven't made that point. It's yes. like one song right into the next one.
Yeah, which, you know, I'm a fan of that because I'm such a Floyd fan. So.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. For sure. And same with me with like Rush. So
yeah. yeah.
So it's totally good. But I tell you what that song reminded me of, too. And I don't know if he was just paying, you know, a little homage or a little shout out. Mm. It totally reminded me of like the serious side of the Bee Gees.
Yeah.
When they have that dum, da da dum, da. And then
yeah.
even the way he sang certain vocals, I think the line was, a girl I don't want to be or something.
Yeah.
It's all like real high pitched background mm-hmm. vocals.
You can almost hear the Gibb brothers singing that.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Once again, a song like this, you know, it's like, is this intentional? Are they purposely trying to take you through? Back through like different eras of music, like Daft Punk, for instance, they do that a lot.
Totally,
and I think that's kind of another example of The Weeknd like exploring these areas mm-hmm. that like, hey, the Bee Gees, you hadn't heard or thought about them in a while. Here you go.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I'm not saying that's what he did, but it very, very much reminded me of like the darker Bee Gees stuff, like Tragedy and stuff
totally,
like that.
Yeah.
Go back and listen to Tragedy, and then listen to this, and you'll see what I'm talking.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. What I loved about this song. Is something you never hear in modern songs, hardly at all anymore. There's space for the instrumentation.
To breathe.
There's yes. lots of breathing room in this
yes.
song.
Yes.
And it never takes away from the intensity and the upbeat tone of the song.
I agree. And then yeah. the way it ends, it's very dynamic sounding.
Yeah.
It's just, it's perfect, man.
It is. It's a 10 for me.
And I gave it a 9.5.
Yeah.
So I'm right there knocking on the door with you, bro.
Yeah. All right. So moving on from that 10 to track 5, Sacrifice. Always sacrifice.
I like this song. It was very, very dark sounding. The yeah. whole record has a very dark sound.
It does, yeah. Well, when you're
talking
doing
about purgatory.
Yeah, exactly. When you're talking about that kind of subject, death and all that, it's got to be a little dark.
Yes, yes. But once again, this is the first song where I felt like the Michael Jackson influence creeping in.
Totally, yeah.
And
yeah.
it doesn't leave for quite a while once it appears.
Right.
Or you can't get it out of your head. You just, you know, it's there.
Right, that's so obvious. True. I loved this song, too.
Me, too.
I gave it an 8.
I gave it a 9.
Yeah.
I did. I gave it a 9. I'm a sucker for dark R&B sounded songs mixed yeah. with vintage 80s keyboards, and that's, you know, what's in the wheelhouse of this thing right here, and I loved it.
Exactly, yeah.
I loved it.
Moving on to the next track, then, track 6, A Tale by Quincy.
It bled into my relationship with family and those I had become
now,
romantically
involved.
Speaking of Michael Jackson.
I wasn't, yes, really, I wasn't expecting this track. It's a spoken word by Quincy Jones himself.
Yeah.
And at first I was like, why is this necessary? This seems like out of nowhere. But flowing into the next song, I'm like, okay, it kind of makes sense now.
I agree.
Yeah.
I agree.
But, you know, it's kind of short, spoken word, so not a lot to say about it.
Yeah.
I gave it a 6, though, because it did kind of like hit a wall. It made me hit a wall.
Yeah.
As far as the enjoyment of the album for me.
I gave it a 7 just based on reputation alone. It's yeah. freaking Quincy Jones, it's, man.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you can't criticize a genius for sure.
Yeah. yeah.
But just because it interrupted the flow for me.
It's not really a song. I mean,
it really isn't.
So it's hard to judge it as a song. It's just kind of like a transition piece into the next thing.
Yeah. Which is Out of Time, track 7.
Go on, dang, dang, dang. You know, it's kind of like that kind of thing, you know, setting you up for what's going to happen.
Exactly, yeah. So, yeah, Out of Time would be the next track.
Yep.
And I really did like this one. At the moment it kicked in, the first name into my head was Peebo Bryson.
Yeah, I think I totally agree. It's that Quiet Storm element, 80s yeah. R&B, ballad land, yeah. soul music.
Which I'm a sucker for that.
Me too, me yeah. too. And you know, one thing, I guess this is the first place I could say this, and I'll elaborate and expand on it a little bit further. This album is, if you're looking for real deep lyrics, you're not going to get it. Out of this album.
That's true.
Even yeah. though it's a dark, deep subject matter.
Yeah.
The lyrics are pretty middle of the road, you know.
They are, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They are. Although, you know, this being the concept album, the impression I got from this is someone in purgatory who's looking back at his life, different times in his life, different situations. And, you know, I think maybe the simplicity of the lyrics is just, that's just kind of part of it.
Yeah, yeah, I would agree with that. And yeah. knowing that on the front end, mm-hmm. you may be able to understand that or appreciate that a little bit more than if you're just judging it song by song. Once right, again, right. you definitely have a Michael Jackson vibe in this song. Mm-hmm. Like when Michael would sing, She's Out of My Life, that kind of texture, tonal quality to his voice.
Yeah.
I'm hearing
yeah.
that in this.
Totally, yeah, and I loved it. I gave this one an 8.
I gave it a 7, so yeah. I'm not far behind you there. I liked it. Liked it a lot.
Yeah, all right. So on to the next track.
Yeah.
Now, this is where I start to get a little disappointed because yeah. the first 7 tracks were so strong, and I'm thinking this is like the best album that we've sat and listened to for a review since we started doing them. I was so enjoying it. But then it started to kind of like trail off for me. Here we go again, the next track featuring Tyler the Creator.
But here we go again. Ooh.
I agree with everything that you said, but yeah. for me it starts with the song after this one.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
yeah.
This one I didn't mind for some reason.
Yeah,
it's very much an easy listening kind of sound.
It is, very much so.
Yeah.
There's no beat to it, though, and as we were listening to it, I remember you were commenting you were expecting it to kick in.
Yeah, it did change at that moment, but not to a beat.
It changed, yeah, and it was a cool change. I liked it.
Yeah.
But the expectation of it kicking in kind of detracted from it for me a little bit.
Yeah.
Because it seemed like it was missing that element.
Yeah, I agree, but then in retrospect, it almost seemed like it's a dream sequence or something.
Yeah.
It's very dreamy. Weird vibey at that moment.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I liked the way it made me feel just mm-hmm. listening to it.
Yeah.
So I gave it a 7.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fair. I mean, it would be, you know, I couldn't imagine taking points away from a Pink Floyd song such as Don't Leave Me Now. You know, it does kick in at the end, but just because it doesn't kick in till the very, very end, taking points off for it.
Yes.
You know, yeah. As it works in a concept album, it's supposed to be that way.
Right.
So,
right.
Now, I'm not much of a fan of Tyler, the Creator, it's my, you know, personally. And that kind of took a few point off for me. I gave it a 6.
Okay. Okay. So we're not that far off on this.
Not that far. Just yeah, a point
we're,
off.
We're yeah. kind of agreeing on this record all the way through. Kind
we,
of scary.
We kind of are, yeah. So let's see if that continues.
And the next song is Best Friends.
Best How about Friends. That? There you go.
Yeah.
Track 9.
And one of my least favorite songs on the record.
That's it. We're done.
Yeah, we're out of here.
You're my best friend, no. You're my best friend, no.
I don't know, man. This song was just very ordinary and boring to me.
Yeah.
It just had the same beat all the way through. I lost interest 30 seconds in. That's me. I knew there was not going to be any surprises in this song.
Right.
And it really just didn't do a whole lot for me.
Yeah, this is where the album starts to drag.
Yeah.
Now, I did love the Depeche Mode sounding drum beat in there.
Yeah.
They really harkened back. But you know, that bumped it up a point for me. I gave it a 7.
You gave it a 7. Okay. Yeah. And I gave it a 5 on that one. So just, yeah. I don't know. Didn't really dig that one. But however, yeah. for whatever reason, the next song did give me a little bump. Now, remember when I say I rate something 8 or higher, I would go seek it out to listen to it again.
Yeah. Yeah.
I gave the next one, I'll tell you up front, I gave it an 8. And the song wow. is called Is There Some Someone Else?
Yes.
And
this is the first point on the album that modern sounds start to leak through.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah. Modern production, modern keyboard sounds.
Yeah.
But yeah. It works. It works in the flow of this, for sure.
It really does.
Yeah.
And I, you know, even beyond that and in the scope of the album and everything, I think it's a really good pop song.
Yeah.
And I liked it.
I did too. I didn't like it as well as the ones I loved before it. I gave it a 7.5.
Okay. Wow, this is scary.
Yeah.
And we do this and we're going live here. We never know what the other thinks or,
right.
or whatever. Yeah. So, all right. So we're pretty much in agreement on that one. Right. What's up next?
Track 11 is Starry Eyes. Back then I was starry-eyed, and now I'm so cynical. Now, this is a track that kind of began to redeem the album for me a little bit. I really liked this one.
And I didn't like it.
You didn't like it, really?
Yeah, this is our first real disagreement. Yeah, this song, I don't know, man, about put me to sleep. I couldn't hang with it for long. It was the first moment on the entire album that I really wanted to fast forward it. I've made this point before on the channel. Mm. Whenever you like something instantly, a lot of times you get tired of it fast.
That's true.
Yeah. So I may end up loving this. I'm going to definitely listen to the album all the way through some more.
Yeah.
I may end up loving this song down the road because a lot of times, like I say, some of the things that I love more than anything in the world, it didn't hit me real hard at first initially.
Okay.
So this, it doesn't suck. I just didn't like it as much as the rest of the stuff, and I only gave it a 4.
Okay. Wow. Okay. Yeah. Well, see, I gave it an 8, so this would be our first disagreement.
Yep.
So, yeah, I liked it pretty well. Next track, Every Angel is Terrifying.
Every Angel is Terrifying.
So this is a spoken word piece.
Yeah, and the best title, the best song title on the whole record.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
But man, I didn't like this.
You didn't like it?
I know.
I liked the atmosphere and the feel of it, and I kind of approached it after the Quincy Jones track kind of jarred me a little bit. I'm like, okay, I need to accept this for what this is. The concept album, it's a break. It's a little narration. So I did give it a 7.
You gave it a 7. I gave it a 3.
Wow.
It just didn't work for me at all.
I love the sounds and the atmosphere of it.
I think because I had such high hopes just reading the title.
Yeah.
I'm a big song title person.
Yeah.
You know, my favorite songwriter of all time is Jimmy Webb, and he has just, you know, MacArthur Park, these big long titles, you know, Wichita Lineman. It makes you go, wow, what is that? Yeah. And this title was like, man, Every Angel is Terrifying. I'm like, that's a great title.
It is, yeah.
And then I heard it, and I'm just like, eh. I was just expecting
your
more.
Expectations were high
based on the title.
Okay, that makes sense. Yeah, absolutely. Yep.
So when I give you my opinion, come on, man, you're talking. It's from a guy here. It's not like I'm some super duper songwriter. It's not like I'm Bernie Taupin or anything. You know, it's just simply my opinion.
Yeah. All right. So let's just go on to the next track.
Sure.
Track 13 is "Don't Break My Heart."
Okay, I like this one.
Yeah?
Didn't love it, but I liked it. To me, it was like a throwback to the late 80s, like Babyface. You know, one thing, it kind of gave the album a little shot of energy, which I think it needed at this point.
Yeah, it did, yeah.
And so it's not a, you know, a fast song. It's more mid-tempo.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It reminded me a lot of like Babyface for some reason. Like that kind of type 80s era R&B pop song.
Yeah.
I gave it a 6.
I gave it a 7.
Give it a 7, okay. Yeah.
I liked it pretty well. It's not one that I would drop into a playlist, but
yeah,
I didn't mind hearing it. I liked it. I actually liked it.
Yeah, me too. I agree.
All right, moving on to track 14, and I'll just say right up front, this is my least favorite song on the album.
It's right there for me too.
I Heard You're Married featuring Lil Wayne.
Yeah, it just didn't do a whole lot for me.
Yeah, it's the verses where The Weeknd is, you know, singing. I don't know. It seemed like there was no cohesion in his thoughts there. It was just, I don't know. I can't put my finger on it. It was boring to me.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, it didn't.
And almost kind of juvenile.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like this is the one that he, you know, rolled out of bed at 3 a.m. because he had a thought and just jotted it down, and then he didn't go back and rewrite it.
Okay. Yeah, I could understand that.
And that's a heavy criticism for The Weeknd. I love The Weeknd.
Me too.
But this is, I think this is the weakest song on here, and it doesn't take away from the fact that he's a great artist. This one he just kind of phoned in, I think.
To me, it was boring and bland right down the middle for me. I gave it a 5. Nothing special.
Yeah.
Probably not a whole lot memorable. I just remember that annoying effect on Lil Wayne's voice.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I'm for the most part, I probably should have knocked it down a point or two, but I gave it a 5. I gave it right in the middle of the road because I didn't want to like judge it completely just hearing it one time. And I mean, even though that's what we're doing,
yeah,
I kind of feel like I would like the song if I heard it a little bit more. I'd probably like it a little bit better. So I didn't want to take. I didn't instantly love it. That's for sure.
Yeah, the vocal effect on Lil Wayne and Lil Wayne's performance dropped it down to a 4 for me.
Okay,
I'm not. I'll just say it. I hope I don't get hate from. You know, all the younger viewers, I'm not a Lil Wayne fan. I never have been. It's not me. You know, I don't like that style of mumble rap or whatever you want to call that.
Yeah.
And yeah, him being on the track, it's like, okay, yeah, that's Lil Wayne. You know, he does what he does and people love it, but I don't like it.
Gotcha.
A 4.
Understandable.
Yeah.
All right.
Track 15, Less Than Zero. We're starting to wind down to the end here.
I'll always be less than zero.
I give this one a 10. I loved it.
Yes. You know, no surprises on this song. You know, pretty much it's laid out. It's structured like a hit song, like a hit pop song.
Yeah.
I predict that's exactly what it's going to be. Mm-hmm. Very catchy. Had some nice acoustic guitar parts in there, which I thought was very nice. Yeah. I really liked it. And the chorus kind of just sticks with you. Once you hear one, it's like, this one, he's got all the goods in this. And it's kind of cool that he saved it for the near the end of the record.
Yeah.
I gave it a 7. The only reason I took anything off of it, my point about how when I instantly hear something that I like, it'll probably wear a little thin on me.
Yeah.
To me, it was pretty much a very calculated, formulated type song, but that's okay. Yeah. That does not bother me at all.
Yeah.
I mean, Journey's one of my favorite bands ever. I love Foreigner. I love Boston. I love all that kind of like formulated music. It does not bother
me at
all.
Nothing wrong with that. Yeah.
That's right. But I give it a good, strong 7 with the possibility of it growing on me even further.
Yeah.
But it's definitely a great song.
Well, cool. This is going right into my playlist as soon as we're done with this.
Okay, cool. Yeah, you liked it that much.
I loved it that much, yeah.
All right,
we're going to close out the album now with Spoken Word by Jim Carrey again on Phantom Regret.
Gone, and your phantom regret hasn't let it go yet. You may not have died.
And I kind of liked this one because it closed out the album, talking about, what purgatory is and how you should let go of all your... Well, like he says, phantom regrets.
Yeah.
It was a happy little message. I kind of liked it.
For me personally, I felt that spoken word part just went on a little too long. It's probably like 3 minutes. I thought he could have wrapped it up in like a minute. You know, like I said, when he went into that part about bang a gong, get it on us. So it's kind of goofy.
Yeah. It's a little bit too long. Yeah. But I really did like the attitude of that DJ, how he was very apathetic to the blight of the person in purgatory.
Yeah.
He was like, dude, you're where you are. I'm where I am. What do I care? No skin off my back. You know, so what? So that it was kind of like an apathetic attitude he was throwing out there.
I got you, but here...
So when he was kind of providing that goofiness stuff, it's like, I don't really care about you. You know, it is what it is.
I agree, and that makes sense. I also went into radio mode. We had done radio before. He's supposed to be a radio DJ playing music. You can't babble on for like 3 minutes like that. you just can't. And to me, that maybe that's why it felt a little long to me, because I'm thinking in terms of, this is a DJ. He'd get fired if he tried to do that playing on a radio station that played music.
That's true. Yeah, but I'm pretty sure he wasn't getting paid for his job, or he didn't have a team of consultants telling him how to do his job
every second. Yeah. All right. Well, I want to.
Yeah, I liked that one. I gave it an 8.
I gave it a 4.
Okay.
All right. So I want to just talk briefly, a little overview of my overall thoughts about.
Okay.
This whole record before we get to our scores.
Yeah, let's do it. Yeah.
All right. So originality-wise, this is tough for me. Lyrically, originality wise, I didn't give it really high marks. I mean, there was nothing on here that I was like, whoa, that's really earth shattering.
Right. Yeah.
The concept is very original.
Yeah.
So, you know, the concept of the overall album, I would give it like, you know, probably an 8. Mm-hmm. The originality of the songs and the lyrics and stuff, middle of the road for me, 5.
Yeah.
The songs overall, I would rate them about a 6.5.
Yeah.
Production, 9 to 10. I mean,
great production.
Really great production. But I just want to do this as a little exercise, so bear with me for just a second.
Okay, all right.
I'm just going to go rapid fire and just listen to these titles and tell me that these aren't titles like you've heard before. And that's kind of supporting my theory about, or my opinion, that it is, you know, lacks a little originality.
Yeah.
All right, so here we go. The first song, I'll skip that because this is the intro. Mm-hmm. Gasoline, How Do I Make You Love Me, Take My Breath, Sacrifice, and then there's the Quincy Jones little intro thing, so we won't count that. Out of Time, Here We Go Again, Best Friends, Is There Someone Else, Starry Eyes, Every Angel Is Terrifying, which is oddly my least favorite song on here, but has the best title.
Yeah.
Don't Break My Heart. I Heard You're Married. Less Than Zero. See what I mean? The titles are lame. I mean, they just are. I mean, there's no way around that. There's, you know, but once again, that doesn't mean that I didn't enjoy the album. I really enjoyed the album overall. Okay. I think it's very top heavy to me. It falters down the finish line.
I agree with you on that. And I think the titles themselves, maybe that's a little bit of a hearkening back to the 80s as well.
Hmm.
You know?
80s not known for their lyrics.
No, not at all. And, you know, right along with the sounds of this album, the production quality, where some of the music sometimes has room to breathe.
Sure.
Why not the titles too?
Yeah. I hear you. I hear you. Overall, like the album, I love The Weeknd. It's kind of funny. Remember he kind of got beat up when he did his Super Bowl performance? Everybody thought it sucked.
Yeah. I thought it was great.
I mean, I wouldn't go great, but I thought it was very good. It didn't bother me. I thought it didn't deserve him.
It was a good effort.
He even said something about the Super Bowl in one of these songs. Did you hear that?
He did, yeah. It went by me too fast, though. I got to listen to it again.
I think it may have been the one with Lil Wayne. I'm not sure about that.
He makes
some kind of reference to something about the Super Bowl.
that's funny. Something. I'll have to go back and check that out.
Yeah. Well, anyway, what did you give it? Here's what we do. We add every song. We get a total. We divide it by 16. That gives us an overall average of the songs.
Yeah, out of 100, mine's a 76.
And mine is a 64.6, so roughly a 65.
Well, mine was 75.9. I just rounded it up.
So. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
So really, once again, I always have to make this point. When it's not like grading a grading scale in school, you know, anything below 70 was a failing grade.
Yeah.
That's about retaining information. This is about enjoyment.
Right.
And so roughly I liked 65% of this album, which is really good. You like 76% of the album.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and that feels very accurate to me.
Yeah. So in the, you know, right in the middle, probably our two scores combined right around 70.
Yeah.
Which is good. I would say that if you like the more upbeat side of Weeknd, you'll probably like the first half of the album.
Yeah.
Not the second half so much.
Right. Yeah, I agree with that. And as far as like the order of the tracks, I'm not going to touch that because this is a concept album. You know,
how he wanted it.
Right. This is the art that the Weeknd created. I'm not going to comment on it. This is how we wanted to do it. This is how he presented it. It's how it's supposed to be.
I didn't have a problem with the order.
I didn't either, really.
Not at all.
Yeah.
But so,
I wasn't even going to try. I'm like, I'm not going to try to move these around.
Yeah, overall, if I had to sum it up, it's a pretty interesting record at this point in the Weeknd's career. I see it doing pretty good. I mean, at least 3 or 4 singles strong.
Yep.
With the possibility of some big-time hits on this.
Oh, yeah. I think so, too.
Yeah.
All right, so drop it in the comments. Tell us what you think of this album. If you haven't heard it yet, go check it out and then come back here and let us know what you thought of it.
Yeah.
For now, we haven't done this in a while. What do you say we play some trivia?
Why not?
All right.
Man, that box is dirty.
I know. Yeah, we haven't broken it out in a while. So let's see how we do here.
Okay.
All right. The 90s.
Ah.
So let's talk about the 90s. Speaking of, coming up very soon. We've got a series of 90s episodes.
Yes, we do.
So hang out for that. All right, the question is, what is the basis of white reggae artist Snow's number one hit, Informer?
What is the what?
What is the basis? So in other words, what is the song about?
Wasn't it about like he was telling on somebody for...
All right, here's the choices.
Yeah, what's the choice?
Working for the CIA.
Yeah.
Being the school snitch, a cartoon clown, or being framed for a murder.
I think it's...
It could either be CIA or being the school snitch.
Yeah, other. But now that the more I'm thinking about this... Man, this is tough.
Yeah.
This is tough. I'm going to go with D simply for this reason. The first two are kind of like similar.
They are kind of, aren't they?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I thought it was about a damn snitch, though. I really did.
Yeah? Well, your intuition may be right, though. First impression.
What was the fourth one again?
Being framed for a murder.
Shake your boom boom down.
We're thinking real hard about this one.
Yeah, for such a goofy song. I kind of like this song for whatever reason.
Yeah, I don't know. I could leave it.
I don't care. Pick one. What are you going to go with?
I'm assuming it's being the school snitch.
Let's go with that one.
And it is actually being framed for a murder.
God,
look at you.
I knew it.
You were actually right.
Yeah.
You're right. So I'm going to give that one to you.
That's all right. Yeah, I knew it was deeper than you would think just hearing the song. I did think the title of that album was brilliant, 12 Inches of Snow.
Yeah. You got to give it to him for that.
Yeah, for sure.
At least he could laugh at himself.
Yeah, I'll tell you a funny story. When that first came out, and I was working in music retail in the 90s in the mall, this fella came in, and the song was playing, and he was kind of like, you know, it's got the like really fast rapping parts in it and stuff.
Yeah.
And he was kind of like singing along with it. He's like, and he like sang with the lyrics, like, if you play this backwards on Vanilla Ice. And it was really funny. And then he sang it like in flow with the music. And yeah. I don't know. It was just funny to me.
All right. Well, cool, guys. That wraps this one up. You know, again, drop down in the comments what you thought of The Weeknd's album.
Yeah.
Click like on the video, and we'll be back again with another episode very soon.
More great episodes on the way.
That's right. They're going to pump out like you wouldn't believe.
Like, subscribe, all that stuff, and take care.
See you guys.
See you.